how do I pronounce your last name, by the way? Because I get it wrong all the time.
I just say Maupin.
Maupin.
I mean, yeah, yeah. I mean, it's probably 100 years ago. It was like Maupin in French or something. But, okay. You know, my family's just said Maupin since the beginning of time.
Because
so.
I figured it was French and I didn't want to be like a terrible English person and like butcher it or sound pretentious by being like Maupin.
Accidentally say Caleb in a French accent. Caleb Maupin.
You don't know how many people think I'm an Arab. They think I'm like Khalib or something. So,
oh my God.
What?
Yeah, so, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. DJ Khalib. I'm going to start calling you that from now.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Well, welcome to Low Society, Caleb. Would you like to introduce yourself to our audience?
Sure. I'm a journalist and political analyst. I come at things from a socialist perspective, and I've written a few books. I do YouTube broadcasts. Glad to be joining you here on Low Society.
Awesome. Awesome.
Well, we're happy to have you.
Yes, happy to have you. Speaking of books, so we hear that the one that you're recently working on is about Kamala Harris. Now, I didn't catch the debate last night. Did anyone here catch the debate? How much of a train wreck was it?
It was pretty bad. It was, I mean, Kamala was pulling a lot of like meme-worthy faces. I think probably on purpose.
Yeah, I made a meme out of some of them, like saying like, this is me trying to become a meme.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they were doing the whole civility thing a lot. Mm-hmm. Like they were really like, I'm so grateful to you for, you know, being so civil and blah, 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 blah. Like, it was very different in tone to the presidential debate where it was sort of like gloves off, like kind of, you know, I mean, like very harsh. Yeah. It was less entertaining. That's yes. For sure.
Basically, just and boring.
Mike Pence has this kind of tough cowboy, you know, look where he's just kind of scowling, you know. I almost wanted to really say, you know, go ahead, Kamala, make my day. Something like that. You know? I mean, it's just, he does this thing. I mean, he was a radio broadcaster in Indiana who blamed Obama for all of Indiana's problems. Then he became a governor of the state of Indiana who then blamed Obama for all of Indiana's problems. And now he's the vice president. So, you know, he's very good at presenting himself, keeping calm. He did very well against Hillary Clinton's vice presidential nominee, Tim Kaine. I mean, he wiped the floor with him because he's got broadcast experience. I would say the debate, the last one, the VP debate, was about a draw. It was about 50-50. I mean, if you really want to name a winner, I mean, if you have to name a winner, I'd say Pence won just because he was able to frame Kamala Harris as an anti-vaxxer. And that moment where he kind of turned the tides on her and said, why are you questioning a vaccine during a pandemic?
Whoa.
Like that
Chad.
Was, yeah, that
Chad
was a
move.
Yeah. 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 So he knew what he was doing. You know, but other than that, I would say it was about 50-50. They both did their thing. Pence did his thing and Kamala had a lot of angry one-liners that were meant to be memes. And she did her thing. Her supporters loved it. Pence's supporters loved it. Every side thought they won. It was what's supposed to happen in the debate. So
did she do an id poll? At all, at any point during the debate, did she try to sort of like?
She did. There was one moment in particular I remember where she, Kamala, was asked a question and she went off on a tangent like, my grandmother would be so proud to see, like, you know, the first black woman. But it was very much like out of place and like to be asked a direct question and then like fly off into this weird, like, id poll shit was a bit strange.
And Caleb, you in Kamala Harris and the Future of America, an essay in three parts, you actually covered her family a fair amount.
Indeed. Well, there's quite an interesting history there. Now, she talks a lot about her mother, Shamila Gopalan, who, you know, immigrated to the United States from India, became a cancer researcher. She will mention her father, Donald Harris, in passing. Mm-hmm. But if you look into Donald Harris is a Marxian economist. The right wing wants to tell you he's a communist revolutionary or something. That's ridiculous. But he taught at Stanford University for many years and he had kind of a Marxist, you know, analysis, of world events, drawing from Capital and other things. He was a critic of neoclassical economics. And, Donald Harris, there was a pretty messy divorce. He was not part of Kamala's life from the time she was 8 years old up until until now. And he has actually gone as far as denouncing her campaign. She was being interviewed on The Breakfast Club, the radio program.
Oh, yeah. My favorite source of tea. Sorry.
They asked Kamala if she'd ever smoked weed. And she replied, "Half of my family's from Jamaica. What do you think?" Well, Donald Harris, her father, took issue with that and came forward and denounced her in the press, referred to her campaign as a travesty. And said he speaks for his entire Jamaican family, that they distanced themselves from it. He actually used the phrase identity politics in condemning it. It was very harsh. Now, what's interesting is that comment from Kamala Harris, where she admits that she smoked marijuana, it's mainly gotten a lot of flack, though, from people in the United States that are concerned about the prison industrial complex, mainly because she destroyed the lives of thousands of people and locked them up for smoking marijuana, and then without a thought says she did it. People have also pointed out that the rap music she says she was listening to does not exactly line up with the time period in which she was in college, so that she may be making the whole thing up anyway. Maybe she didn't smoke marijuana. She's just pandering. Like, who knows? It's a very strange episode.
I mean, maybe she smoked weed as a deputy district attorney in California. I mean, that was the era that Snoop and Tupac came out, right? 91, 93. Maybe it's that she was smoking weed that was left over from the weed that was confiscated from all the arrests that were going on in California when she was working for the state.
How dumb do they think that black people are? Like, is what I want to think. Like, they can just be like, yeah, I smoked weed, Jamaica man. Like, look at me and like Tupac. And then like black people will be like, yes. Like, I remember when Cardi B did her interview with Joe Biden. The one thing that I've ever agreed with Candace Owens on was the fact that, like, it's pandering, like the idea that the Democratic Party would select someone who has nothing to do with politics, but who has influence. And it's not as if Cardi B only has influence among black people. She has influence widely because she's a fucking massive celebrity. But the fact that Joe Biden thought that that would sort of secure him the black vote, as if black people don't care about material issues. We just care about like weed and celebrities, man. Like, it's offensive and terrible. And, you know, one of the things that we're super critical of here is the fact that these sort of elites are able to sort of leverage identity in a way that obfuscates class and also protects their class interests. And I feel like, you know, that's kind of what someone like Kamala Harris is emblematic of. And I know that you write a lot about that in your book. Would you like to talk a bit more about that?
Well, I mean, while we're on the subject of her little mistakes and her pandering, I believe more recently she referred to Tupac as, quote, the best rapper alive. And immediately
Did she call him a goat? Like, fucking.
Yeah, Twitter lit up with people saying maybe she knows something we don't know. Maybe there's like some inside information. But for the most part, most people saw that just as an embarrassing gap. But in the book, I use her to make a point. This isn't a biography of Kamala Harris. This is an essay in three parts where I'm using her to make a point about how left-wing politics has become distorted. And I talk about the history of CIA manipulation. You can go back to the Congress for Cultural Freedom program, MK Ultra, and how there has been a big effort to move left-wing politics away from class struggle, organizing for the rights of working people, and move it in a direction of what I refer to as a crude Freudian manipulation, you know, giving people permission to be angry, to unleash their impulses, and that is potentially serving imperialism. And I talk about Kamala Harris and her ties to the faction that ran the Hillary Clinton State Department.
Yes.
That's the thing, though, because you mentioned Freud, and that's kind of how I feel about the current iteration of the left, is that it's just pure id, that it's just one big id monster. Just pure impulse, you know, completely divorced from competency and rationality, which is why they hate you for wearing suits, Caleb. They don't like your suits because it pokes at their shadow selves. It pokes at their shadow selves.
Indeed. I've gotten a lot of flack for wearing a suit. I'm not wearing one today. I guess it's a weekend.
Yeah, it's a weekend. Yeah. I got a collar, so. Nobody comes to low society in a suit, to be fair.
I made the right decision.
It's interesting, though, because it's an aesthetic criticism, which seems to be a lot of what they focus their energy on. And the fact that, like, your aesthetic is like what they would deem as like normie, the fact that normie aesthetic kind of pokes at their shadow is interesting because it seems as if there's a fetishization of the fringe, where and sort of a demonization of just like not like things that people do that are kind of general or ways of being that are more general in that regard, which isn't political at all, but they turn that into the primary domain of politics, these sort of aesthetic and cultural differences and disagreements.
Yeah, well, one of the criticisms I've had leveled at me, which is an interesting one, but I get it a lot, is they say, well, he calls himself a Marxist, he speaks about Marxism, but he argues like a libertarian. And I've been perplexed by what does that mean? I argue like a libertarian, but I've looked into it. If you press people, I cite economic data. Mm-hmm. I talk about facts. I'm not just screaming about who's a racist and who's a sexist this week and getting, you know, I'm actually, you know, speaking, you know, and making rational arguments. And somehow we've handed that over to the right. Well, that's a nightmare. If the right are the only ones that make rational arguments, that's very, very disturbing. Now, as far as the suit thing, though, It's amusing. Years ago, I was talking to a socialist I knew who was getting a job in a labor union, and he was becoming an organizer for the SEIU union, and they require their organizers to wear suits and ties when they go out and visit workplaces and do their union organizing. And he was saying, oh, that's so reactionary or whatever. But then, you know, I noticed that, you know, if you're in a neighborhood in the United States and someone's running for city council and they're going to knock on your door and say, vote for me for city council, they're going to be wearing a suit and tie, you know?
Yeah.
And that working class people tend to respect people that wear suits and ties. This kind of idea that we're going to be left wing, it means we're going to have ripped jeans and we're going to be as sloppy as we can. You know, I heard in the United States that among people of color, there's actually a joke about how can you tell how wealthy a white person is, and it's by how badly they're dressed.
Yeah,
you know, and
Mark Zuckerberg.
And that dressing badly is almost a class privilege kind of thing, right?
You're right.
It is. Because people, the thing, and I notice it in the UK as well, where class is like a lot more obvious in that regard, is when you go to people's houses that are working class, they're so much more meticulous about being clean. And they're also really meticulous about their kids being clean because they already have like a stigma associated with them. So it's like, and also when I was growing up, like my mom would like make my brothers go to school. When we went to a school when we were young that didn't have a uniform, but she would make them go to school in like shirts and like black shoes and stuff because it was like, you know, I want my sons to, because they're already black, which is a thing that works against them. I want them to be sort of taken seriously. And unfortunately, that sort of respectability, because it is respectability politics, but it's sort of a defense mechanism against sort of wider societal judgments. And you talking about messy dressing, you're offending Jake's culture, by the way. You just barked up the wrong tree, mate.
Not at all. But I mean, I would say recently, I guess there are examples of the contrary. There was that guy who ran for like mayor of Norwich for the Green Party, and then he became like an MP and an MEP and went to like represent, you know, the UK in the European Parliament and stuff. And he was dressed like a regular guy, wore a massive gold chain, sort of, you know. He's called Majid something. Yeah, I can't remember. Yeah, but yeah, you say, you know, some people do just respect the honesty, I feel like, sometimes of like a dressed down person. They see that there's no bullshit to it. There's a lot of bullshit that gets sold to people by people in suits, which is why, so like, that's why sometimes I feel like that's the inherent like distrust from some people. But then I don't know, it works both ways. I can see both point. I'm not trying to make a point here. I'm just like, I can see.
Well, the thing is a billionaire in street clothes looks inauthentic. Like, there's something about it that just, it's not possible to be authentic looking. And a poor person in a suit always looks like somebody who's like going to a job interview or something. They're trying to project that professionalism to be taken seriously.
I think you hit the nail on the head in terms of authenticity is the thing that matters the most. And for a lot of the people who wear the ripped jeans, there's something uncanny about the fact that it's inauthentic, that it's this sort of haphazard attempt to appear like cool and like down to earth and approachable when they're not really. So I think the authenticity is what matters and not necessarily these sort of aesthetic qualms. But I can understand where the respectability politic comes from when you're in a community that has a sort of stigma attached to it about being like dirty and ill-educated and ill-mannered and all of those different different connotations.
And I think there's a generational question too, because a lot of the old boomer leftists that were active during the 1960s, they very much resented any of the formality. Like, you know, right, I was in a socialist group for years, and the younger people in the group, we always thought it would be great to end the meeting with everyone standing up and singing the Internationale. But the older people in the group were all like, oh, people hate that. You know, that's that formality, that tradition. But for their generation, you know, it was like, we're not going to do things that are traditional or formal. We're not going to dress fancy. We're joining the movement to be loose. Whereas for younger people, they're joining the movement because they want to be part of something. You know, there's this trend, people laugh about like, quote unquote, LARPing. You know, like live action role play, where you meet a lot of young communists and they almost start dressing in like costumes, like they think that they're, you know, and that's unfortunate, right? That's unfortunate, but it shows that there's an element of, you know, people that are interested in socialist politics in this generation, they do want to be part of something. They're not looking to hang loose. They're not looking to just kind of, you know, lift social restraints. It's kind of the opposite. They want to feel like they are part of a community that has unique traditions, that has a unique history, and standing up and singing the Internationale at the end of a meeting is a way to kind of do that. It has a different meaning, I think, that a lot of the traditions, you know, coming out of the Second World War, the post-war years, there was a lot of militarism in U.S. schools and a lot of authoritarianism. A lot of that's been lifted, right? So it's not the same stigma if in a socialist group you want to kind of implement that kind of
thing. Well, yeah. And I mean, we're such an atomized society that the idea that people are looking for somewhere to belong, I mean, it can be taken advantage of in terms of creating power structures that end up co-opted or recuperated back into the capitalist structure. But at the same time, like, we have people who are very much yearning just for some place to be that feels community oriented or collective in some way, because we all feel so separated, you know?
True. Mm-hmm. Well, Caleb, you will be fighting me if you try to part me from these harem pants that I'm wearing. They're very comfortable. Okay. And I can be a socialist and wear harem pants, and you can be a socialist and wear a shirt. Welcome to Low Society, everyone. Be sure to check out our Patreon if you have the extra cash to throw our way, and also check out our Reddit. Give us 5 stars on iTunes, because, you know, it helps the operation run. And also check out Caleb's book. Where can people find it?
It's online, Amazon.com. You can get yourself a copy. Other places books are sold. Kamala Harris and the Future of America.
Well, I'd like to move on a little bit to something I've heard you talk about quite a bit, which is sort of the stratification that has emerged in these sort of weird online, like, leftist sect cults. And I think that your sort of definition and your analysis of it is one of the most apt that I've heard so far. So would you like to talk a little bit about what you've noticed in terms of the different cliques that emerge in this sort of simulacra of leftism?
Well, I don't know. I mean, there are people who just kind of appear out of nowhere and suddenly become the voice of socialism with thousands of views. And that's pretty bizarre. And then
they used to call it COINTELPRO.
Well, yeah, there you go. There are a lot of strange notions on the Internet now. I think one of these commentators said that socialism would be the same as everything is in the United States currently, except every company would be jointly owned by the workers, right? There would be like an employee stock ownership program. And I'm thinking, well, no. And in fact, you know, if everyone who worked at Boeing, for example, got a share, wouldn't they be way more enthusiastic about war? Right. I don't think that would solve the problems. If every, you know, worker at a company that pollutes massively had a share, wouldn't they be very enthusiastic about lifting environmental laws? If profits are still in command, if it's still production organized for profit, you're not addressing the problem with capitalism. The notion that socialism is simply the creation of worker cooperatives, that is not what socialism is. Socialism is a society where the banks, factories, and major industries are organized to serve public good and not profit. It is reason and scientific thinking applied to the economy. That's what socialism has always been. But there are some very confused notions out there. I mean, we have the old, you know, well, if there's any authoritarianism in this society, it's not really socialism, right? Socialism is this pure egalitarian thing. Those notions have been around. Trotskyism, anarcho-syndicalism, these notions have been around for a long time. But now there are some even stranger formulations of this. It seems like now that there is such widespread interest in socialism in the United States, we have various influencers that have kind of popped up out of nowhere that are telling us, number one, what socialism is, which is very different than we've always understood it. But number two, they are trying to line us up to support U.S. foreign policy and its hostility toward China and its hostility toward Russia and its hostility toward Cuba and Venezuela and the actually existing socialist countries. And that's very concerning.
Yes.
It's true. It's true. What about factionalism in terms of how the Marxist left is sort of portrayed and sort of the different forms of obfuscation that are levied to? I know that you've had a lot of experience with people sort of summating your personality, beliefs, morality unfairly. Welcome to the club, buddy. we've all had our run-in with that sort of thing here. So would you like to talk a bit about that?
Well, I mean, I think that anyone who's going to put themselves out there on the internet, you're going to have to deal with a lot of garbage. And compared to what women deal with, I mean, you know, men, we get personal character attacks. We don't get people sending us dick pics. We don't get, you know, I mean, compared to what women go through, you know, I mean, it's nothing for men. But at the same time, though, I think that there is a level of, you know, it's like this cancel culture where if you don't agree with somebody on one thing, mm-hmm. right, that becomes, you know, whatever. And the thing is, I talk to all kinds of different people. You know, I have actually had an interaction with President Trump. You know, I was at a press conference in March of 2016. He said, one last question. Who's my favorite reporter? You. And he called on me. And I asked him about foreign policy, and he answered my question. So I have spoken with Trump. Wow. You know, I have interacted with, I have debated against people on the far right and ripped their views to shreds. I have met with people in Iran, you know, figures in Iranian politics. I have met with figures in Russia, and I have no qualm about that. Just because I meet with somebody does not mean that I endorse everything they've ever said.
What? That's so weird. That doesn't sound right. That's not repping the brand properly. Like, that's not how social works at all.
Yeah, they believe it's like osmosis or something, or people who will like police who you follow on Twitter. Like, are you aware you're following someone who is fash adjacent? And it's like, I don't care. Like, oh, it's just, I'm just following them on Twitter. It does not mean that their beliefs are going to rub off on me or some ridiculous notion.
Yeah.
And it never seems to apply to U.S. imperialism.
No.
Right? I mean, these same people that are like, oh, this person is friends with this person who's friends with this person who's friends with this person, so therefore unfriend them, are like, vote for Joe Biden, who invaded Iraq and killed millions of people. Yeah, I don't understand that. You don't get canceled for associating with the U.S. mainstream. You get canceled for associating with people in dissident movements who the mainstream doesn't approve of. And that's very bizarre to me.
It's definitely because they're sort of there to police the discourse. It's sort of a punitive and disciplinary discourse that they've created that sort of keeps these sorts of conversations out of mainstream view. And sometimes it almost feels as if it's organized. I've definitely had things happen to me where it's felt organized, for sure, like organized harassment, organized smearing. And it seems as if they're sort of doing the job that, you know, law enforcement did, you know, back in the day. And I don't want to say that they are COINTELPRO, blah, 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 because, you know, why speculate? But I feel like social media platforms in and of themselves, the metrics that exist on them, the incentives that they place before us, basically make us become our own COINTELPRO in that regard. And, you know, even the way that Twitter, as a platform like Twitter, is set up, like Twitter shadow bans for, you know, using certain terms, or if the algorithm spots what you're saying as potentially aggressive, or even if you go after someone higher in the hierarchy than yourself, if you're retweeting tweets of influencers who are blue check marks in a way that Twitter deems as hostile, they'll do things like, you know, hide your replies, decontextualize your tweets, not make your tweets appear in people's feeds. So, you know, it's not as if these social media platforms are here to give us room to own the libs. They're there to protect, you know, the journalists and the influencers and the people who kind of bring the most foot traffic their way in that regard. So I feel like the platform in and of itself is the COINTELPRO. I don't think that there are but there are, of course, people who do organize harassment campaigns against people who they dislike. And it always begins with smearing and moral smearing. And obviously, because this sect of the liberal left is preoccupied with morality and moral panics, you know, that's what they tend to try to go for. They try to create a moral panic around a specific figure that they dislike.
Yeah, well, one thing I will say is that I feel like there's a really big difference from social media, just putting out social media content, and actual left-wing organizing. Mm-hmm. Because in actual left-wing organizing, you have to associate with people you who disagree with.
Exactly.
Yeah. Whereas on social media, if you fight with people, like, it's like it gets you more attention. Right. Yes. So there's an incentive on social media to clash with people, to call out people, to condemn them. Whereas in real actual organizing, it's the opposite. You want to build unity to actually get something done. And I think that is underlying a lot of this as well. Yeah,
for sure. For sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I would say you particularly got a harsh end of that recently. Well, not recently, but in recent months. And as somebody who has done a lot of the real life organizing, who has actually spent time not only organizing, but also doing reporting on, you know, state activity, et cetera, do you want to talk about that at all? Do you want to address the thing?
I don't know. I mean, it's interesting to me. ContraPoints, probably one of the most famous trans YouTube channel. I mean, you know, very good politics. She has been canceled as a transphobe, right? I'm somebody who, you know, here in New York City, we protested against the NYPD for their policy of profiling trans people, which they did, you know, and they still, profiling trans people in their sex worker, crackdown and, you know, arresting trans people and profiling them as potential sex workers. I went to the Trans Day of Action.
Physical, actual, you know, showing up and doing real work. I mean, protesting the police, that's not a non-risky thing to do. It's not entirely safe to protest the police, you know, and it sounds like you were actually, you know, doing the work as far as like actually organizing and advancing an agenda which helps trans people. Right.
But yet, you know, none of that matters. Right. The fact that I interviewed somebody who had, you know, a position on the transgender issue, that and then I didn't argue with them or something like that is being used against me. And honestly, you know, I don't really know enough about it. And I almost don't want to know about it, because at the end of the day, right, I would not stop supporting someone's human rights. I would not advocate hate crimes or discrimination against somebody because of some ideological question. Right. I don't know the science behind it. I know that there's a lot of debates about it, and I don't care. I'm for an end to discrimination against trans people. I'm for full rights to trans people. I'm for equality. I'm for everything. I mean, I don't understand why does this result in condemnation? But even me addressing this issue right now, I can guarantee you this is a lighting up. There are people that are just filled with rage the way I'm talking about this right now. And it's like, I'm sorry, but there's nothing I can do to satisfy you. The sex worker issue is very similar.
When you basically say trans rights and they're like, no, you didn't say it right.
Yeah.
The fact that they got upset with you for interviewing someone with a different perspective and you weren't like doing the Twitch debate me bro shit, that's what they always want. Mm-hmm. Like they want it to be like a blood sport when they see a leftist discussing an issue with someone. They had the same issue with Zizek when he was talking to Peterson, because they wanted Zizek to turn it into some kind of like what screaming match, some kind of like insult thing. Yeah. Like, but because they were both civil with each other and they were discussing ideas rather than launching personal attacks, that was seen as a big problem. Yeah. And it's just an overall issue that leftists need to overcome, like this idea that every interaction with someone who is not aligned with you has to be hostile.
Exactly. There's also I have an understanding of what those people, because when I back in my Radlib days back in 2016, when I was just a wee little Radlib, I was very sort of on the sort of black kind of identitarian train at that point in my life. And there's this whole kind of, and when you absorb that worldview, which I think is somewhat it's prevalent within that specific constituency, it's like, if you don't understand me and if you don't immediately sort of capitulate to my view of how I should be treated and viewed and understood, if you're not making the effort to understand every way that you could possibly harm me, right, whether it be advertently or inadvertently, then you are an enemy. And that's sort of the line of thinking that kind of floats around within those identitarian circles is that you should know, and if you don't know, you should be like spending time poring over. Like, I remember, because it was like very early in me and Jake's like relationship, I would be like, okay, so you need to read this, and you need to read this, and you need to read this. And he's like, I don't need to read this not to hate you. Like, I fuck you. I put my penis in you pretty regularly. sorry. But in my mind,
conversation wasn't quite.
It just
that.
Took a turn.
One thing I've noticed is there's kind of a lack of
just
nuance.
Doesn't miss a beat. Caleb, the real pro here.
Yeah.
But there's kind of a lack of nuance, right? Where it's some of the attacks on me perplex me because it's like he said this thing, and this thing he said sounds kind of like something completely different that is said by somebody on the right.
Yeah.
And doesn't it kind of remind you of maybe the same thing there?
Yeah.
So therefore he is on the right secretly. And it's like, you hear that, you know, and it's like, what?
Yeah.
For example, George Soros is a real person, right? The Open Society Institute is real. George Soros is a real person. But he's not a communist.
No.
Right? He is not a communist.
He's
this is a
billionaire.
Person who toppled the Eastern Bloc.
Owning class.
This is a person who is vehemently anti-communist. And the right wing is going around telling people, oh, there's this evil communist George Soros who's behind every left-wing cause. And if the response of the left, basically, according to these people, all you're allowed to say in response to that right-wing thing about George Soros is you're supposed to say, that is not true. You are an anti-Semite.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, no. George Soros is a real person. But he's an anti-communist, number one, right? And number two, real left-wing politics is very different than what George Soros promotes and believes, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we can't have that conversation. We can't have a nuanced conversation. It's either – if either George Soros doesn't exist, and if you acknowledge him, you're anti-Semitic. And if you say anything other than that, if you acknowledge the role that he played and the CIA and what they did in the Eastern Bloc and Jeffrey Sachs and all the stuff, there's a really important conversation that needs to be had there.
Yep.
But it's almost – it reminds me – you know, I grew up around a lot of evangelical fundamentalists and they you know, people talk about thought stopping in a cult, right?
Yep,
you talk about evolution, right? They say, I believe the Bible. It's 100% true.
Mm-hmm.
You say to them, what about the fossil record? Oh, I believe the Bible. It's 100% true.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is what these people are doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
You say, George Soros is a real people. You're an anti-Semite. You're an anti-Semite. It's not true.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, it's a way of stopping people from thinking, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
That we need to be able to talk about these things, right? And that there are there are things right-wingers say that, you know, they always say the best lie has a grain of truth in it, right? I mean, and they will take true things and distort them.
Yes.
And if leftists are not able to then talk about the actual nature of what's going on.
Yes.
You know, I mean, a great example years ago, Alex Jones, the right wing, we were pushing this FEMA camps idea, right? That, you know, that Obama was building these camps and he was going to round up all the right wingers and put them in prison camps. This was during the Obama years. And he cited this law called the McCarran Internal Security Act of 1951. Which was a law that was passed during the McCarthy period that gave the U.S. Department of Justice permission to assemble a list of communists and dissidents, leftists, who would be rounded up and put in prison camps if the Soviet Union invaded the United States or something like that. Well, the law has been overturned by the courts. It's no longer good law. But Alex Jones and the far right wing Tea Party were going around saying, you know, that this law existed and all that. So I get an email, one of the mass emails of the Southern Poverty Law Center, and they're going over top right-wing lies, right? You know, lie number one, FEMA camps. No such camps have ever existed. No such law has ever been passed. No, there very clearly was a law that was passed. It was just to be used against communists, number one. And number two, it was overturned by the courts. But when you say that law doesn't exist, all somebody on the right has to do is look up
exactly
that law, and they say, lied, and the right wins. And what? But Southern Poverty Law Center is too afraid to have a conversation about McCarthyism? Like, I don't get
this. No, it's absolutely.
It's a partisan brainworm that I see all the time where, I mean, there was even stuff where, you know, drugs that actually do work to slow the progress of COVID, simply because Trump mentioned them, doctors would have to say to patients, like, is this something that you're interested in? Or there are patients who just flat out refuse to take the drugs because Trump mentioned them, or anything that is the right wing is right about, because they're not wrong about everything. Like you said, there's a grain of truth in every falsehood. It doesn't matter. We obfuscate that territory and inevitably surrender it to them, which gives them more power. One of the really interesting things that you talked about was this idea of, covert transformation of the meaning of socialism and the mechanisms that sort of work behind transforming what socialism is actually supposed to be and the mode that we have today.
Well, you know, the book on Kamala Harris is kind of a smaller version of a much bigger work that I have in the process. I'm writing a book about how leftist politics has been distorted during and since the Cold War, and that there was an operation. The CIA brags about it on their website. They consider it one of their greatest achievements was this Congress for Cultural Freedom program, where they began covertly funding leftists, artists, intellectuals who were anti-Soviet, right? Trotskyites, social democrats, various people started covertly getting money from the CIA. And if you look at the work of these artists and writers who were covertly funded by the CIA, like Susan Sontag, for example, she's one of their great ones, Hannah Arendt, what they wrote about is they basically saw leftism as about kind of protecting intellectuals from the masses, right? It's they kind of see the mob as kind of this inferior group of rabble, and we need to protect the intellectuals from this inferior group of rabble. That's kind of the theme of a lot of their work. And if you read Susan Sontag's writing, where she goes as far as declaring that communism is nothing but the most successful form of fascism.
Wow.
And it's all, you know, and that she, you know, she's claiming that gymnastics is fascist, all kinds of things are fascist. This is fascist. That's fascist. Everything's fascist. And all these things that are considered left wing are fascist. Well, it's fascist because it's the common people getting together. They're being organized. They're demanding their rights. That happens on the right. Sure. You know, the right wing, builds right wing fascist demagogy and such. But it also happens on the left. Right. That according to these folks would think that the industrial workers of the world, the Wobblies, were fascists. These people would think Eugene Debs was a fascist. basically any mass movement, any mobilization of people for truth is fascist. Hannah Arendt, she was hanging out with this milieu, and she wrote this book, Eichmann in Jerusalem, which I read. It was assigned to me in college, and I read it. And it's a good book about, you know, this Adolf Eichmann, who was a Nazi and was arrested in Argentina, taken to Israel, and executed for his crimes during the Holocaust. And she writes in her book about what an ordinary person Adolf Eichmann was, that before he joined the Nazi Party, he was in the YMCA. His arguments at his trial were very cliche. He was just a normal guy. Now, at the time that I read that, I saw that as this powerful statement against conformity, right? Don't conform. Don't go along with the man and the system. But if you really read the book, what she's saying is that deep down, ordinary people are potential Nazis, right? And that it's a lot like the way Ayn Rand in her writing speaks about the ordinary people. They're the mob. They're this dangerous group of people. And so, right. And they equate communism and fascism because they're both mass mobilizations. They both say that there is actual objective truth in the world. They both call on people to sacrifice, and they equate all of that with fascism. And leftism is simply about protecting intellectuals. And that is very, very dangerous. But that is very much the work of CIA manipulation. And it was about, covertly cultivating these intellectuals to use them against the USSR. I mean, it's now public record that, you know, Dr. Zhivago was very much a result of UK and US intelligence. They cultivated Boris Pasternak and tried to cultivate a layer of intellectuals in the Soviet Union that were anti-Soviet. And that was about eventually bringing down the Soviet Union. So this all played a role, and this is all well documented. This sounds like tinfoil hatty stuff, but it's really not. Mm. I mean, it's really not. You know, this is well public record information that the way leftist politics has been intentionally distorted, the way Marxism, Leninism and socialist populism has been replaced with this kind of do your own thing, man, use drugs, you know.
There's something distinctly Malthusian about the way that the kind of new iteration of the left views the masses, or the idea of mass populist movements. It kind of reminds me of that documentary, The Century of the Self. I think it was like an Adam Curtis documentary, where he sort of talks about Freud's nephew, what was his name again?
The Edward guy Bernays.
Bernays, yeah. He talks about how Edward Bernays basically sort of took the idea into companies, that advertisement and consumption needed to be attached to these sort of abstract values in order for people to become repetitive consumers. And it was sort of the way that capitalism it neutralized the idea of individuality, because obviously in the 1950s and before, the manufacturing methods were incredibly uniform. So you had a bunch of things that looked the same. And then in the 60s, there was this sort of like, you know, revolutionary like period of people, you know, ideas and stuff. And people wanted individuality and they wanted to be able to express themselves in a way that was unique. And there were certain iterations of that that were authentic, but then capitalism then was able to sort of to that by selling people the idea of this sort of unique branded type of personality. What you're saying distinctly reminds me of that, because the way the left is now, it's sort of codified all of those sort of consumer aesthetic and intellectual kind of academia centric ideas and created this sort of brick house around it that shields it from the real populist ethos that the left is supposed to represent. And it's populist broad appeal, there's such fear attached to it. And I feel like that's where accusations like class reductionist
come from. That's what I was going to bring up. They start with that shit.
Yeah, it's anytime anybody tries to take a broad appeal to populism, it's basically treated with the same fear and suspicion as fascism. I just actually made a video about it, and I was in the guise of like the Joker. And it kind of reminded me of how when the Joker movie came out, people were like, oh my God, it's like an incel manifesto. They're going to kill us all. Whereas it just showed like a poor white mentally ill loner who's struggling through like capitalism in this like really dystopian world. And the idea that it resonated with people really freaked these people out.
Indeed. Well, you know, class reductionism, it's weird how these words become like they go out and all of a sudden everyone's on the same page and they're witch hunting for the
same. Yeah, everybody knows them all of a sudden.
Yeah, and it's the same ideological crime. And like, you know, I mean, when you talk about class reductionism, my understanding of class reductionism is like there was a Marxist group, I won't name them, but they were around and they would chant at their rallies sometimes, white power, black power are the same, racism is the boss's game. Well, obviously that's class reductionism because it's not true, right? Black people fighting for their rights and white supremacists are not the same, right? That's class reductionism as I understood it. But now this notion is if you just talk about things in economic terms, that's class reductionism. I don't know. Yes. I don't get that.
And that's been propagated by certain personalities.
Rhymes with gosh.
I would also say that if you are pro imperialism, is that not a form of class reductionism? Right. I mean,
absolutely.
Because I always understood class reductionism. You know, there will be like, you know, the USA will be, you know, trying to overthrow the government of Libya. And you'll get these elements that are like, well, Gaddafi's the boss of Libya and, Obama's the boss of the USA. I'm for the workers. I'm not for either side in this. Well, you're being a class reductionist because the imperialists are trying to destroy an African country. Right. That's class reductionism. You know, so I don't get that at all. I was surprised to see that allegation going out there because I am more in favor and sympathetic to black nationalism and non-Marxist anti-imperialism than most people. I mean, and I will defend Minister Farrakhan. I have great admiration for Minister Farrakhan. I don't agree with him on LGBT questions and the issue of anti-Semitism.
Well, that's that whole essentialism bullshit. You have to either fully endorse or fully denounce a person or a group because they have a bad view or because their leader has a bad view or whatever. Like, you can't possibly look at things from a heterodox or a nuanced perspective. It's just not allowed. It's like with the various countries that have attempted socialism in like the 20th century. Like, some of them were organized in a way that isn't ideal. And I mean, mistakes were made. In some cases, atrocities happened. But that doesn't mean that you have to just be like, well, you know, that thing never did anything that was positive or progressive or worked in a manner. Like, of course, the Nation of Islam has problems. Duh.
I have seen what the Nation of Islam has done.
Right. And again, you bring up a time where you actually physically have experience with the issue that a lot of people who are critical of you just outwardly don't.
Yeah. I have been to Iran with the Nation of Islam, spent a long time with their leaders in Iran at a very important conference about the Black Lives Matter issue and black liberation in the United States. In Cleveland, I worked against police brutality and I saw how they organize on the streets. I worked with many ex-prisoners who talked about their prison work. The Nation of Islam, despite their flaws, I'm not a member of their religious group. I don't agree with their religion and they don't want me to. I'm a white guy. But I respect the work that they do despite their views. And those who would equate Minister Farrakhan, the leader of the Million Man March, the people who would equate him with people on the far right, that's class reductionism, is it not?
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting to me, though, because you bring up the Nation of Islam. And I mean, the Nation of Islam did give us Malcolm X. But at the same time, you know, it's a difficult one because these sort of traditional religious forces can be incredibly grounding for vulnerable communities, especially for young men who are usually rudderless in these communities. It gives them a sense of purpose, meaning. It gives them something to do. It keeps them out of trouble as well. But at the same time, it's, you know, traditional or traditionalist lines of thinking oftentimes carry reactionary elements with them, which is the reason why it's sort of a kind of like, it's like the church. The Black Church, for instance, is another one of those things where the Black Church was like the birthplace of civil rights. It was also the sort of propelling force for the civil rights movement. And obviously Martin Luther King was a reverend. And the fact of the matter is, it was a grounding sort of force. But at the same time, there were certain reactionary elements that came out of the cultural, traditional aspects of that thing. And it's difficult because it's hard to critique in that regard.
Sometimes we have to accept that, you know, people aren't perfect and groups of people are especially imperfect.
Yeah, well, I will never forget, you know, when Libya was facing an onslaught, right? I mean, you know, 2011, during the height of the Occupy Wall Street protests, all of a sudden Obama is unleashing a torrent of missiles against Libya. And, you know, leftists, I was protesting it with the International Action Center and some other groups. And we had small rallies of, you know, white leftists and others that opposed it. Black Agenda Report took a good position and others. But we had tiny rallies. Most of the left kind of supported the bombing of Libya, said, well, we don't support the bombing, but Gaddafi's no good, and had marched in support of what was later proven to be a CIA, you know, led revolution against Gaddafi. But I will never forget going to the Millions March in Harlem and seeing just crowds of thousands of people, tens of thousands of people that filled the streets for the Millions March in Harlem against the bombing of Libya, you know, supporting Gaddafi, supporting the anti-imperialist struggle of the Libyan people and opposing what Obama has done. I mean, Libya hasn't recovered. I mean, it's been almost 10 years, 9 years at least, that Libya has just been in shambles as a result of what was done. And all of these leftists kind of sort of supported it. And the Nation of Islam stood against it. And that, in my mind, I do think that was an issue where, I mean, you cannot argue that what happened in 2011 in Libya was good for the country. You can say whatever you want about Gaddafi, but you cannot say that the results of the 2011 revolution have been good for Libya. Look at Libya now.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, you're talking about, you know, the individual, like, ruler of the country, which, I mean, it could either easily be good or bad in any situation, and probably was both in a lot of different situations, versus bombing the living hell out of a country. Yeah. Like, that's the, like, it's night and day. And we act like, because one thing is in our heads a certain way, that the other thing is okay. And it's just not.
Mm-hmm. And that there's been a use of leftist aesthetics in these campaigns to build war. I mean, there's, you know, in Venezuela, they're always wearing a Guy Fawkes mask, always a Guy Fawkes mask in that crowd of rich kids who don't like Chavez because he's taxing them too much to pay for schools or something like that. I mean, you know, there's been a hijacking of left-wing aesthetics by imperialism, and that needs to be discussed. We should be able to talk about this.
Yes.
What you were sort of saying about the CIA and all the shifty stuff they do, and I think Gaddafi in Libya is a pretty classic example of that, because wasn't, like, the main thing he was trying to do is basically build, like, a centralized African bank that would have, like, taken it away from the main, like,
the IMF, basically.
Yeah. And, like, that was that's capital. That's big. That's a big boy move you're talking about there. So they're not going to let that happen at all. So of course they're going to like absolutely punish that country that's like, you know, trying to make this grand effort to try and alleviate some of the economic pressure upon the whole continent of Africa.
Furthermore, it's widely acknowledged that one of the biggest factors in the Arab Spring was the fact that there was a drought and people did not have access to water. Well, what country had the world's largest irrigation system before the Arab Spring? Libya. Gaddafi built the great man-made river, the world's largest irrigation system, and Obama bombed it to shreds, you know, and that needs to be acknowledged, right? I mean, we can talk about global warming and climate change. I'm all for talking about that. You brought up Malthusianism before. You know, I mean, Marx wrote polemics against Malthus, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, in his, you know, theories of surplus value, he rips Malthusian thinking to shreds.
Mm-hmm. He also took big dumps on his face, too, just basically like dunking on him. Like he was really, he hated Malthus. He did not get too emotional in his writing at all, but he did personally insult Malthus multiple times.
Right. And the Malthus is basically opposing the notion of historical progress.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah, and that's why we leftists call ourselves progressives, right? We believe in humans advancing and getting further. But if you watched a lot of stuff that's coming out in left-wing circles now, there's this notion that we don't want to advance as a species. I mean, I accept global warming and climate change as a result of human intervention. I accept that.
Yeah.
But I say the answer is progress. We need to get beyond fossil fuels. We need fusion power, you know, fusion energy.
Hell yeah.
This notion that we need to just reduce consumption. Right. And that we just need everyone needs to be poorer at the environment. You know,
oh, my God, you are speaking the language of Peter Coffin here.
You know, that is very much what Wall Street and London want, because the reason that Wall Street and London rule the world is because they dominate oil. Right. You know, it's look at the big banks on Wall Street. They're oil banks. Right. Another one of these attacks. Someone said, well, he never criticizes energy companies, just bankers. So he's anti-Semitic. Well, I actually wrote a whole book, Oil and the Global Capitalist Crisis, where I talk about, you know, HSBC Bank. That's BP. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Bank, yeah. Exactly.
That's ExxonMobil. Right. And that the big banks that run our economy are also big oil companies. Right.
Yep.
And they dominate the world because they have this resource. We are in a global economy that runs on oil. China is a country that imports oil and sees that as a weakness. That's why they're trying to protect the South China Sea. The oil tankers come through there. And China wants to break out of that prison for humanity called the fossil fuel economy. They want to get us to a higher, not a lower, but a higher energy source so that we can, you know, have energy that doesn't result in climate change. And we need to be optimistic. We need to approach these things. And how can we continue to advance as a species? Not how can we go backwards, right? That is the basis of fascism, right? Julius Evola.
Yeah. Who's had kind of that's reactionary politics. It's literally reactionary politics. It's reactionary. The definition of it.
The thing is, you would expect that sort of reactionary politic, the sort of Malthusian idealism from the right wing and from eco-fascists and stuff like that. But the fact is, it's becoming codified on the left in these sort of covert ways. I mean, when you hear certain aspects of the liberal left, like Extinction Rebellion, talking about, you know, things affecting the planet through global warming, they're almost making useless eater arguments about the masses. I mean, even the whole the yellow vest protest that happened in Paris about and France in general about the fuel tax that was being put forward, there were a lot of people in the liberal media who were saying, oh, look at these scum, they just want to pollute, you know, this sort of argument that they should be consuming less and that they shouldn't be protesting because the reason that the fuel tax is in place is to protect the environment, whereas it's sort of putting the onus of for the excess of big business on working class people.
Don't use plastic straws. Really, it's bad. It's bad.
Yeah, it's bad.
Indeed. Well, the Rockefellers, you know, I mean, they are probably the source of a lot of the mainstream liberal politics that we have. The Rockefellers were in the Republican Party, but they gradually became more and more uncomfortable in the Republican Party as the Cold War went on. And they were kind of pushed out, right? The Rockefeller family were the main funders of Planned Parenthood, which was originally called the Birth Control League. And it wasn't because they believed in women's rights. It was because they were Malthusians. Yeah,
exactly. Because Sanger was a fucking overpopulation freak.
Right. Yeah. Indeed.
She was part of the Eugenic Society of America, basically. It was a whole thing that a bunch of people from the elite were involved in, and they didn't want poor people breeding.
In July, they actually finally denounced Sanger at Planned Parenthood back in July. In this year, in 2020, they finally, like, you can easily look up, like, her writings. Like, she has essays on overpopulation and how we need to limit the breeding of the underclasses. It's like, it's fucking, like... It's amazing it took until 2020.
Sounds like Winston Churchill.
Even then, like, major feminist figures like Gloria Steinem were people who were funded by the CIA.
Yeah, it's funny that she defended Bill Clinton during the Monica Lewinsky thing. Funny.
The entire sort of cultural revolution of the 60s, those who were pushed to the forefront of pop culture, many of them had parents who had ties to the military industrial complex. Like,
I have a really interesting one on musicians that are tied to that. So I think it's one of the members of the Police, his dad was a founding member of the CIA.
Wow.
Wow.
Well,
it's just,
mean,
like, and then he's got a band called the Police.
The military industrial complex is very, very essential to the U.S. economy. So if you're going to be well-connected, I don't think that's necessarily with Jim Morrison and Janis Joplin and all of that. It's necessarily a big conspiracy. I think it's just that with the U.S. economy, you know, the circles of power are very much centered around the military and the intelligence agencies. So it's a matter of being well-connected. What is well-documented, though, is MKUltra. Right. And the CIA was working very hard to get people on LSD like crazy. Fidel Castro dedicated one of his columns to this, actually, before he died in the Cuban newspaper. And Grandma, he had his reflections. He wrote he quoted the writer Daniel Estulin extensively in one of his in one of his columns, talking about, you know, how the CIA worked to put drugs in there. Woodstock, right? Woodstock is supposed to be this great moment. There are some interesting articles by people who actually went there and said Woodstock was kind of a nightmare. It was all these people from New York City, New York State. They end up going to a place. It's not there for them. And, they're trapped. They don't have enough food. They don't have any place to use the bathroom.
It was the original Fire Fest, basically.
Yeah. In a lot of ways, you know, if they had tried something like Woodstock maybe 100 years ago, the people would have, like, rioted or something, you know? But I think what Woodstock proved is that you can put people in very, very desperate circumstances where they don't have enough food, don't have enough bathrooms, but if you give them enough LSD, and they'll take it, right? I mean, it's this great festival of peace and music. I think it shows that we can be socially engineered. I mean, it was the record companies that did it, but they were also, let's not forget, all the stars at Woodstock were flown in on military helicopters. That's a little detail about Woodstock that people don't keep in mind, and that there was a huge moment of real left-wing activism in the streets of New York City and the streets of the country at the time, and getting everyone to go to this non-political rock and roll concert to use lots of drugs, and that was a way of kind of diffusing a lot of the stirring social unrest at the moment.
And then in 1999, they did the same thing, but instead of LSD, they forced Limp Bizkit on everybody.
There was a book that came out, I think, just before lockdown this year, that this guy had been doing this essay for Rolling Stone or something, that then turned into a 25-year investigative journalistic piece on how the CIA essentially employed Charlie Manson as a plant, and that whole not the whole thing was planned exactly the way it went down, but they let him out of prison multiple times, and they kind of guided him in all these kind of different ways, and let him off the hook with all these different ones. The parole officer kind of basically didn't give a shit about him breaking the rules so many times. They knew exactly kind of what he was doing and what he was planning and all that stuff, and they were just go and do it, and then do it, let's kill the hippie movement, just fucking kill him.
What I think is particularly bizarre, I don't know about that, I'll have to check that out. I mean, it doesn't surprise me, but what I think is particularly bizarre is that, you know, Charles Manson, he was very much used in the media as kind of this is why hippies and counterculture are no good. But what's very bizarre is, you know, the Weathermen or the Weather Underground, right? They supported Charles Manson, and they actually started saluting each other with four fingers because he allegedly killed someone with a fork. And so they started doing the fork salute. That was kind of their thing.
Oh, geez.
And that a central point of the Weathermen's ideology was that the white working class are, quote unquote, pigs. They're not revolutionary. and that only people of color have any revolutionary potential. It was kind of like there's this book, Settlers, that's floating around now that is very popular. And that was kind of the thesis yeah. that the Weathermen believed in. They promoted this, and so much so that they admired Manson because he you know, killed these white movie stars or something. When actually, if you look at it, Manson, from what I understand, he was trying to frame the Black Panthers in his killing.
Yes, he wanted race war.
That's the thing, because I've always been super fascinated by his helter-skelter theology. Mm. And basically what his idea was that by, because it was a time in U.S. history where sort of the civil rights movement was rising and, you know, Black people were sort of flying in the face of power in a way sort of never seen in American history. And this sort of unsettled a lot of people. And his whole theology was based around the idea that race war was imminent. And because the Black people in America had so much anger and so much sort of righteous anger against the establishment, that they would win the race war against the whites. And then him and his cults would hide in the fucking California desert, and then after the race war was over, they would then conquer the Blacks and become king of the world. Basically, that was what his whole theology was based around. But he was an esoteric fascist. He was very into sort of Nazi occultist ideas. And the Beach Boys as well. He was into these sort of Nazi occult ideas, he sort of based his theology around that, because he sort of thought that the Negroes, quote unquote, righteous anger would lead them to victory over the whites, but because whites are superior, him saving himself would then mean he would be the natural master of the Black people that were left, basically.
You see some weird stuff like that in the old 60s New Left. There's a really strong white savior complex that you will see that a lot of older baby boomer leftists have.
Oh, if only we could have voted Obama in for a third term.
And that there's this like, you know, it's almost like, like, you know, I noticed this from some old baby boomer activists. They would tolerate social conservatism among people of color in this kind of condescending way. Like, of course you're anti-gay, you're Black, but that's okay. Of course you're religious, you're Black, but that, you know, but among a white, if a white person had these reactionary views, you're in the Klan, you need to get out, you're scum. And it was, that's racist in a way, right? If you were, if you kind of expect people of color to just not be as politically developed and that's okay, that's racism. I mean, I mean.
Well, they clearly believe they can expect less from the Black person. It's racist. Yeah. Right.
There was never any patience with white people that might have problematic views. But there was just a huge amount of patience with people of color coming from a condescending white savior place. And I always noticed that as a double standard that bothered me in left wing circles among the old baby boomer crowd.
Where do you think all of this is headed to? Obviously, there's kind of a massive sort of astroturfing of what socialism is that's going on at the moment and is continuously perpetuated by the social media platforms we're on, the incentives that, you know, are placed in front of us on these social media platforms, the fact that, you know, there's a lot of obfuscation and gutting of the idea of class politics. Where do you think all this is headed, and how do you think that people who are principled on the left can combat this?
Well, I think we're actually going to be moving in a good direction, because at this point, I mean, the class issue in an economic crisis like this, it's going to become the center, and it's going to have to. And I think that people on the right are gonna have to get over their hatred of communism. And there may be a lot of people on the right that'll start exploring genuine left wing ideas. And I also think that there are going to be many people on the left who are just going to say, I'm sick of this. Right. I mean, look at how popular the Hill with Crystal Ball is. Right. I mean, there's a lot of people on the left like yourselves that are tired of this identity politics, that are tired of this weird controlled opposition stuff, and are going to start moving in a better direction. And it's only a matter of time. It's just we have a lot of, you know, baggage from the Cold War to get over. And you know, we don't have institutions to come into this. You know, the 1930s political upsurge, you had the Socialist Party, you had Eugene Debs, you had all this mass socialist consciousness that could then give birth to the Communist Party, the struggle of the 30s. Now there is no consciousness. There is no consciousness. I mean, people have no idea what socialism is. Socialism is taxation. Socialism is the post office. You know, I mean, people have no idea about any of this. And we have to reassert this ideology. And that's what's needed more than anything. That's why I'm in the process of trying to build a think tank. I'm not trying to build a new party or anything like that. I'm trying to build a think tank. that will just engage in trying to revive genuine socialist, anti-imperialist politics, because that is so absent from the discourse right now.
Absolutely.
And you know, I will tell you, you know, when I was 15, I discovered the writings of William Z. Foster, the leader of the Communist Party of the United States during the 1930s. And what I read, it was amazing because it was written in a way that was intended to be very, very clear and to the point. It wasn't in this hyper academic way where everything's obfuscated. It was very to the point. And that, you know, you look at William Z. Foster and his writings towards Soviet America, you know, I mean, the communists of the 1930s were trying to build a mass movement of working people. And that's what's needed now. And it's going to happen. I mean, it's going to happen, right? One way or the other, it's going to happen. They're trying to hold it off with everything they've got right now. They've got, you know, racism, the far right trying to whipsaw American workers against each other, trying to, you know, whip up all this settler colonial racism and Ayn Rand, you know, hatred and contempt and killing of human compassion. And on the left, we've got this confusion, this identity politics, this individualism. But I think, you know, it's a material reality. People are hungry and they're going to start fighting for their rights.
Yeah, it's true. Agreed. It's true. Well, before we close out this evening, two things I normally ask our guests when they come on the podcast. What's your astrology sign, Caleb?
I'm a Capricorn, just like
now. Oh, so you're an earth sign. Very material. And yeah, it makes a ton of sense. Like Capricorn is the most conservative sign, not necessarily politically, but in terms of the way one views processes and life. And also it's an earth sign and you're a materialist. Ha 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 ha. So yeah, that's enough woo for now.
Okay.
Also, kill, marry, fuck, Vosh, thought slime, or bad empanada. You have to choose.
Oh my goodness! I have no answer to that question. So
you totally blindsided him with that.
You're gonna die,
and also everyone else.
Yeah. Right. I'm already married, so I can't marry any of them.
No.
Murder is against the law in the United States, so I can't kill any of them. And fuck, well, I don't know. They're not my type, none of them. So I can't really answer the question.
Oh, masterful deflection. Yeah, very, very good answer.
You managed to weasel your way out of that like a true communist.
Sorry, just make it look like an accident, you know?
Make it look like an
accident. Yeah, just kind of saying it in a different way, you know? Yeah.
Jake has been watching The Sopranos, so, you know. Well, thank you so much for coming on Low Society, Caleb. We had a really good time talking to you. Please check out Caleb's book. Would you like to plug it again just for those who missed it?
Kamala Harris and the Future of America, an essay in three parts. It's an analysis of leftist politics and where it's going and what needs to change. And yeah, I hope people check it out and enjoy it. Thank you for having me on. It's been a real pleasure. It's great.
Oh, thanks for coming on.
Yeah, definitely. Come again, definitely. You have some really
absolutely come again.
Interesting insights. Thank you guys for listening. Please check out our Patreon. Check out our Reddit. Check out our Twitter. Help us out. We have big ambitions. Visit lowsociety.net. Buy your vitamins and your Nutrioms.
And your apocalypse shelter too.
Yeah, your apocalypse shelters too. We sell those. Thank you guys, and Very talk good. To you later. Bye.
Bye guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.